Are we ready? Okay. Happy Wednesday, everybody. Professor Adel, happy Wednesday. So welcome to the panel called On the Death of Scientific Visualization, also known as the Death Panel. So we're very lucky to have some distinguished high-ranking geeks on the panel, distinguished selection of geeks. Mike Kirby, David Laidlaw, myself, Klaus Mueller, Han-Wei, Shen, and Anders Ynnerman. I'm trying. Mike Kirby could not join us today due to a motor vehicle accident, unfortunately. So let's dig right in. Is it there? Oh, okay. Let's try that again. Sorry. Yeah, that's the one. I guess a lot of people have seen this beautiful visualization. It's not that easy to see right now. It's easier to see when you're playing with it on your desktop, but it's called CiteVis 2 from John Stasko's group. A very beautiful visualization. And I was playing with it in my office, as one does. And you can visualize citations. So you try to find your own paper in the different tracks, and then you see if anybody's ever cited your paper. So that's the exercise I was doing. And I showed it to some PhD students. And I said, look at this cool thing from Georgia Tech. And yeah, they said, oh, that's cool. And I said, look at the interaction. I'm not showing the interaction right now. And one of the students, the beautiful Richard Roberts, said, oh, look, you can see the increasing InfoVis track and the increasing VAST track, but it looks like SciVis is shrinking. So you can see at the bottom the SciVis track. And somewhere around 2004, it starts to contract, generally speaking. I don't know how well that's showing up for the audience, but you can see a peak around 2004 and then a general contraction trend until today. And I looked at this year's, I know I'm using my psychic powers right now, and I know what you're thinking collectively. Oh, well, what about this year, Bob? Am I right? Yeah, definitely. So I counted 30 papers, the SciVis papers this year, and by my non-professional judgment, it's the lowest number in the history since these numbers have been counted since around 1995. So I thought, wow, that's a cool panel topic right there, as one does. So it raises some questions, and that's what we're gonna answer all these questions today, because it's gonna be great. So will the number of papers keep decreasing in the SciVis track? What could be the cause of the decrease? Should we be concerned? Is anything wrong? Are any changes necessary? How does this compare to the historic growth of other successful conferences? And what might we learn from this? And just for fun, I did look at some other conferences, the number of papers appearing at other conferences. So here's one that you probably all know about, IEEE CVPR, a high impact vision conference. And you can see a trend, an upward trajectory trend, an expansion trend historically. That's the SIG graph, a SIG graph example from the last 10 or 15 years. It shows a general upward trend. Here's another one. I just like this one better. It's IEEE CVPR again, but I just like the 3D bar chart better. 3D is so much cooler than 2D. Wait, that was a different panel. And Tobias Eisenberg was kind enough to show us this nice visualization that shows the different tracks and the number of citations for each of the tracks. And if you can read it, you know that there's a decrease. It looks like there's a decrease in some of the areas we're talking about today. So that's it from my side. We're going to have our first distinguished speaker, David Laidlaw. We're going to go in alphabetical order. So David, Klaus, Han-Wei, Shen. no, surname. Han-Wei, Shen, and then Anders.
Technology worked. It's good. Well, happy Horseless Carriage Day. You guys probably didn't know it was Horseless Carriage Day, but I had to do something after Happy Wednesday, which I knew would be coming from the first speaker. So I arrived at my bed and breakfast on this trip, my Airbnb, to find something a little bit unusual next to the bed. Oftentimes you check in and there's literature about restaurants, and there's literature about sights to see and things to do. This is what I found. This is a first for me. I've never gotten literature from a funeral home as I checked into an Airbnb. And at first I was a little nervous because I thought, I hope I don't need this. And then I realized, wait, I do need this, and here it is. So, and I think this is really a message. This is a message that, you know, SciVis, something's dead. And the most likely culprit is probably SciVis. Oops. I don't know why this always happens to me. Okay, so the premise of the panel here is that maybe SciVis is dying. I'm going to try to answer two questions. You know, that one's a yes or no one. And then the other question is, well, what do we do? And as DataVis Bob mentioned, SciVis publication counts are going down. Bill Lorenson foretold this sort of before they started going down, I think, in his Death of SciVis paper, where he talked about how we're kind of running out of customers. And so there's evidence of that. I think there's also, if you look at the last graph that that Tobias gave to us that shows the total number of publications at the conference and in TBCG, it's not maybe so dire. But it is true that SciVis numbers are going down. So I want to sort of speculate a little bit about why that might be happening. I have a couple of conjectures. One is that there's a lot of tracks, and maybe some of the other tracks are more compelling. Maybe something's cooler than SciVis. Maybe something's more specific or more targeted to the actual topic you have for your paper, so you send it somewhere else. Maybe you have this impression that SciVis reviewers are too harsh, and so you're going to go to a different venue and get the nice reviewers to review your paper. So I think all of those are pretty likely, and that kind of shifting is, you know, pretty common as fields change over time. We're looking at trends that have happened over a long time. It's sort of natural that SciVis would be the one where that would happen, since it was the first, and since most of the other channels have kind of, or tracks have kind of emerged from SciVis and taken a group of people or of papers with them. So that's kind of my first conjecture. I'm not going to actually, well, we'll get to the end when we get to the end. My second conjecture is, okay, there's some hot new topics. There's machine learning and data science. They're going to handle everything. All of this is dead. We're not going to need people anymore. We're just going to give it to computers, and the computers are going to give us back the answers. So maybe in 50 years, I should be dead then, so it'll be safe to, nobody can tell me that I was wrong. But I think we all believe that people are going to be needed for this kind of analytic process for a long time. It may change, the process may not be exactly the same, but it's pretty clear to me that people will be involved. And it's great that machine learning is bringing some of the maybe more repetitive things or the things that involve huge amounts of memory or huge amounts of computation to help people do their analysis, but it's not going to get rid of the analysis altogether. I'm reminded of the fear that all of the software jobs were going to be exported out of America, but it's not, they're not all gone. There's a lot of people still doing software in the United States and everywhere for that matter. So I think that those particular fears are overblown. So I kind of don't believe that that conjecture. I think there's good evidence that it's not true. So my third conjecture is that we're done. SciVis is finished. There's no more knowledge to create. We've created it all, or there's no more interesting knowledge to create. And I do kind of see a little bit of evidence of this. I find that my, Bill Lorenson sort of was talking about this in his paper, I think. I find that there are fewer potential collaborators who come to me with hard problems and say, oh, help me, I don't know what to do. And the ones that do are, well, there's still some, which is a good thing. I think that, you know, in a sense, we are done with some things. There's a lot more software out there for people to just pick up, take to their labs, plug their data in, and get out some visual answers that they can, you know, they can do all by themselves. Here I'm reminded of, you know, the web, people self-publishing, people creating animations. These were all things that 20 years ago you couldn't even think about doing without, you know, crazy amounts of work and special expertise. And now my son makes animations on the, you know, on the floor of our playroom and posts them on YouTube and people can look at them. And he did this when he was 7. So, you know, visualization is a little bit the same in the sense that a lot of those people who used to come to us with problems that they weren't able to do themselves now can do a lot of that themselves. But I do still have collaborators who come to me with hard problems. They're harder problems than they used to be. They're different problems. They're not like, oh, I have this CT data set. How can I look at it? Okay, I think we're pretty much, we've got some really solid solutions for that. Maybe not every particular kind of CT data set and every kind of scientific problem. Certainly there are areas to fill in that area too. But they come with, I have 1,000 CT data sets, what do? I have 20,000 simulation runs of something and I have to be able to understand what's going on in them in 20 minutes. So these are a different kind of problem, a different class of problem. So I don't think we're done. We're done with some of the problems, but we still have plenty of hard things to work on. And a lot of them still remind me of Fred Brooks's computer scientist as toolsmith paper from way back. And anybody who's had me as an advisor has read that paper, maybe multiple times. I do send copies of that to many people. And I commend it to all of you if you haven't read it, or if you haven't read it recently. It talks about going out and finding those collaborators, those folks that have a hard scientific problem, and solving that problem on their terms, and from it, getting richer computer science research. I think Ben Schneiderman has a similar message as part of his new book, which he talked about in the Believe session this week, that in-depth collaborative case studies can be really valuable to get SciVis research going and doing interesting things. So this third conjecture, are we done? I don't think we're done, but it's not quite as it always was. So my fourth and last conjecture is that maybe the field's going through kind of a phase change. Maybe we're maturing and the type of problem is not quite the same. And actually that's kind of consistent with all of the conjectures, and it's really my personal favorite. I feel like, you know, one thing you can count on is change, and I think that's happening. It's going to happen to all the tracks. In fact, it's probably already happening to all the tracks, although some of the changes are turning into new tracks. So when I talked about having 20,000 simulation results or 1,000 CT scans, well, there's LDAF. And that's something that's emerged, you know, in the last, I don't remember how long ago it started, maybe 5 or 6 years. So maybe in a sense, because of these changes, SciVis is dying. But I think that this death is really kind of an opportunity for a sort of a rebirth. So as they would say about, you know, the kings on their tombs, SciVis is dead, long live SciVis, next SciVis. Blah, 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 right? Yak, yak, yak. What does this all mean? What should we be doing? How do we reinvent SciVis? So that's the second question I want to try to answer. And I have a really, I don't know, a simple sounding solution, which I think is actually really difficult. So I think we need to do good research and present it well. That's it. So, okay. Now I spent 30 years now trying to understand what that means. And so maybe it's not quite as simple as those 20 words. And I spend a lot of time teaching students what it means and writing reviews, trying to help people who have submitted papers figure out what it means. So it's really, that's a really hard thing. It's many, many careers of work. In fact, it really is what we are trying to do in our careers, is to understand what it means to do good research. So, but let me just go into it a tiny bit, because I can't spend a career up here today. That was not long enough. The session isn't long enough for that. So there really are two things that you need for good research. One, you need to make new human knowledge, new knowledge that adds to the collective human knowledge of our whole race. That sounds kind of scary, but really that's what you have to do. And the second thing that new knowledge has to have is it has to have some significance. So it can't just be, I made a new algorithm for calculating isosurfaces, and it's, you know, and then you look at it and it's full of bugs and it's three times slower than the other algorithms. That's not really very interesting new information or new knowledge for the human race. So sometimes the importance is obvious. I found a new species of animal. That's, most people would not argue that that's not an important addition to human knowledge. But sometimes you actually have to demonstrate it or have some proof of it or at least explain why it's important. My algorithm, it's faster, it's more accurate, it's more effective in some way. People can get some new information about it. It solves a problem that's not quite the same as the problem that people were solving before. Or I have a new theory. My new theory actually explains some things that the old theory didn't explain. It's stronger, or it explains them in a different way that can be generalized differently. So those are the kinds of things that give you a sense of the importance of something. We can also talk about how it's going to apply, how it's going to change the world. So that's the good research part. The presented well part, I think, is actually, if you've done the good research part right, it just happens. And it happens if you focus your presentation on the new knowledge and why it's important. If instead you say, I spent 3 months writing this subroutine, and here's the list of features in my software, that doesn't get across, usually, the novelty or the importance of the work that you've done. So really, focusing on that is what makes the presentations, I think, go the best. So the real challenge in all this is for us to keep our minds open, to understand how we can do good research, how that's going to change, because it's going to change. It is changing already. And to figure out what those new kinds of contributions are. We're doing it. It's happening in different tracks. But we've got to keep doing it and do a good job of it. So good luck to us all. And I look forward to the conversations we'll have after these prepared presentations. Thanks.
I thought you could. Oh, HDMI. Hello, everyone. Thanks, David, for some inspiring remarks. Good publishing, I mean, that's very important. So here's my contribution to this panel that I was invited to talk about, the death of scientific visualization. So what is going on here? I think I have the death of my laptop. What's going on? Okay, the death panel. Bob coined that term in his email. That got my attention, that's why I didn't delete the email. So, you know, if you live in the United States, then you probably know the Obama death panel. And I just typed in death panel in the Google image, and I got a few cartoons like this. And, you know, it says like, you know, it was like this like in the few years ago when Obamacare was introduced, the Republicans or any opposers were saying they were just going to have like a death panel of people that judge if an old person has to die or not, right? So he was like, stop, we couldn't do anything for you, grandma, we wouldn't have wanted to be a burden to the system. We didn't want to have to be a burden to the system. Okay, and sort of, this is sort of like CiteVis now, right? At least that's what the panel's theme is, right? But, you know, look at the right-hand side, you know, help, I'm still alive. That grandma is not dead. Okay, so here, help is still alive. So let's talk about this a little bit. So Bob, that was actually on the header of the email that he sent to me when invited me to the panel, this graph that shows about the citation history from the citation site at GitHub. Okay, when you look at this, I looked at it immediately, and I'm a positive thinking person, okay? I see like there is a trough there, 2013, and there's a height in 2005. I think I had a paper there. And, but there's when you look at it, there's a period, right? 2095 is about the same level. Then 2015, 16 actually looked, there wasn't data on 2016, right? You can see this, the number of published papers. It's like goes down, it's like bulging out. Then 2005 is the height, and it goes down, and now it goes up again. You know, so there's a period, okay? So, 20 years. And then it's amazing when you type in 20-year period, you'll arrive at the 20-year cycle of fashion. It's actually, there is a cycle. It's a well-defined cycle. It's science, right? It's over and over, 20 years, 20 years. And you know that when you look at these things, and I live in New York, so I'm like sort of at the pulse of fashion. If you live on the East, in LA maybe too. I see a lot of reappearance of Doc Martens shoes. I mean, I lived long enough to know Doc Martens and actually own an old pair that I can now pull out and wear again. And flannel shirts, actually I do have a flannel shirt, I can wear it again. Baby doll dress, I don't really own a baby doll dress. Platform shoes, I think I have some higher heels because I'm vertically challenged, so I have a little higher, but I wouldn't call them platform shoes. Bell bottoms, I used to have bell bottoms. They're coming back. So it's amazing. You can actually see this in the streets. You can see people that wear bell bottoms. And chokers, I actually don't know what that is. Crop top, fringes. Or maybe I'm not that fashionable that I think I am. So new in 2016, bell bottoms. At Target for $24, $24.99, you can buy them. There is Doc Martens on the bottom. That's a model on a runway, you know. And Doc Martens. And as I typed this in, you know, Google is just like a treasure trove of interesting things. So, there's actually someone named Emma, and her name, she was two, and she looked like this in 1996. And then they had a picture of her in 2002. Exact same look. Flannel, the same flannel. I don't know if this is made up. The mom posted that. Actually, it wasn't Emma, it was the mom's. Was mom. So I looked up a little more and I found this hipster fashion cycle, which is you know when you apply. So let's see this about hats. Okay, let's see. You know, hat is like a SciVis paper. Then you'll see here, 2015. That was like 2005 is like the mainstream. Remember I told you this was like the peak of SciVis. Had a lot of papers there. Mainstream, the masses catch on because before there wasn't, right? Masses catch on, and everyone wears the hat now. Everyone's sending about SciVis paper. And it goes down, there's a decline. We saw the decline. You know, the hat peaks in popularity and loses some favor, because now everyone thinks, SciVis is too much, and then the rejection rate was probably higher, you know, they thought, oh, let's look for something else, I need tenure, you know, I need to write something that they get accepted. So they moved in other domains. There wasn't, I think VAST was just coming, right? And InfoVis and stuff like this. And then this one is good, iconic. Oh, sorry, I'm going backwards. Ironic, that's actually a few people start wearing the unpopular hat as a joke. So if you publish the paper 2011 in SciVis, you were actually a jokester. This is just what this hip, okay, I'm not saying you are actually one, but you know, according to the hipster cycle, you are. And then 2016, then you go to the nostalgic cycle, and then we go to the conservative one. This hat has become a genuine article of sensible fashion and a sign of good taste. Okay, so all of you guys that published in 2016, you know, you got good taste. It's good. But, you know, you're still away from it, right? So we're now going 2020. I think this may be a little compressed or accelerated. It's up to us, actually. Become an outsider. Someone bored with conservative fashion wear a new hat that the majority of people, like, wears a new hat. A new hat that the majority of people find in poor taste. Okay, and I think this is actually the breakpoint, right? This is where innovation happens. Because you're writing a paper that maybe gets even rejected. It's so visionary that it gets rejected by the reviewers. Okay, it's so amazing. And later on, so, you know, I have two papers, I'm just kidding. Like that, you know, that later wins the best poster award because, you know, you compress it down a little bit, make it more palatable, have a little more work to make it a little more enamorable to the audience. These papers happen, you know, when you look at MRI, the NIH proposal was denied by, it became like a mainstream technology, right? And stuff like this, right? So these things always happen. You have an innovative idea, so it's completely out of the box. Most people reject it because they're still in this other cycle, right? In the ironic and mainstream, right? From the past, right? So basically that's the opportunity, right? So we're still a little bit away from here, like 2025, actually we're back in mainstream. Maybe we can accelerate a little bit. It sounds a little bit depressing, but you know, we can probably accelerate a little bit. And where we go back into mainstream, that's, I have a positive aspect of this. So I want to tell you a little bit what my thoughts are, how to actually achieve this and maybe accelerate this a little bit. So there is something called reimagination, right? Where you actually reimagine something. Like those Doc Martens, okay, they haven't really changed. But those bell bottoms, they look different than they looked like 20 years ago or in the 70s, 20 years before that. Like fashion never returns exactly, it's reimagined but driven by parallel trends and innovations, okay? There's always something else going on that influences this particular trend. That just means you just can't pull out the bell bottoms from your closet from a long time ago, take the mothballs away and then wear them again. So unless unfortunately, they don't look just the same. So I have this Mini car, for example, right? This is the Mini from a long time ago, Mini Cooper, and this is the Mini Cooper now. You can see the Mini Cooper has grown. It has become much more like modern looking, curvier a little bit, you know, a little more amenable to the current, you know, look of cars and bigger wheels. And then you know, this actually, it's like this guy is actually failed. I had a friend who had one like this. I mean, I don't know how he got into this car. Like, but anyway, now that you can get in much easier. So they got a little bigger, more roomier. You know, they got more technology now, sensing technology, self-cruise control, even self-parking. All these dashboards, you know, they're now OLED displays, and many more things. They've like got the new look, right? When you look at the old Corvette Camaro, the Corvette Camaros and the new Camaros, they look like the old Camaros, but they got so much more stuff in them now, right? So they like reimagined with new technology, refashioned, and so on, right? So for SciVis, what can you do? Like you need new trends will reinforce reimagination. Like there's now, as David also said, there's data science. There's lots and lots of data that you need new stuff for that. There is VR, virtual reality, there is augmented reality, all these new gadgets, right? You know, fashion always, people wear gadgets, and those gadgets are new, right? Now the bell bottoms come with the Apple Watch, right? They don't longer have a digital watch, right? Now they have an Apple Watch, right? And stuff like this, right? So there's new gadgets that accessorize these old trends. And make them new, look new, right? So you know, this is our chance, right? There's Oculus Rift, Google Glass. Why not, you know, we can't do this with Google. We have to just adapt to these things, right? New York Times had this beautiful, you know, thing, this new beautiful series on panorama view with the iPhone, right? We can do the SciVis data too and then become appealing to the mainstream, right? So right now we look a little, maybe a little odd to our own community, But to the mainstream, we will be looking. They will all start copying us, right? So they will look, embrace this. So it also, fashion also commonly borrows from other fashion, right? So we can do, you know, D3, we can all use D3, which is like InfoVis technique. You know, we can use that in CiteVis, why not? We can do volume rendering, we can even port our techniques to the other techniques, to the other field, like we can do volume rendering in InfoVis. We're working on that kind of stuff. Machine learning, we can all incorporate machine learning, predictive user interfaces. All of this stuff can come in to CiteVis and make a difference and reimagine the field, okay? For our, its own style and density. So what we need is, we need innovative designers. We need actually conferences, calls for paper, committees, chairs that embrace these kind of things, right? That don't just say, oh, this is an InfoVis paper, this can't be here. We want to do only fluid dynamics and we want to look at flow fields. No, they need to invite this stuff, put it in the call for papers, and when they come, like, when these papers actually come, embrace them and accept them, right? And then make session titles that have that in it, so people get so people see this in the program and come over to the session and become friends with CiteVis and then contribute, right? Steering committee members, very important, right? Steering committee has to be very aware. I've served for a long time on steering committees, I'm no longer serving. But so my appeal goes to these people that do this to really embrace this. And we also need daring fashionistas, that's you. Those are the authors who enthusiastically actually embrace these new trends and send their papers to CiteVis and make it, I'm not a Trump supporter, but make it great again. You know, synergize and re-inspire designers. Okay, don't get me wrong. So my closing statement is, arguably the name CiteVis does sound a little old-fashioned. Okay, so I remember when CiteVis came up, we all thought, but it is old. Bell bottoms sound old fashioned too, but you know, people wear them. They even call them bell bottoms and Doc Martens, right? So this stuff, it doesn't mean it's dated. It just means it has a good history. Then some may think that Sci is less cool than Info. Sci, you know, it's a little bit like need math and integrals and things like the Info. You just plot a few dots, you know. I do InfoVis too, so, you know, but now we have data science, you know, we can large data, we can put this in there, we can emphasize in the sci, we can emphasize data science, and then informational data science, right? So it's, you know, we can do all this, right? So data science is the new twist that's making CiteVis cool and fashionable again, right? So data science is actually our chance, and also for grant funding and so on, right? We can bring all this in. And then, okay, so go CiteVis fashionistas, designers, do it, and next year, and so on, go up in the hipster cycle and move up to the top again. Okay, that's it. Thank you very much.
My name is Han-Wei Shen. So I suppose this is a guest panel, you're the juror, and I need to really try to be a lawyer, try to argue and why you should save yourself's life, our life. Okay, so I'm gonna look at this thing from different facts, okay? So that is CiteVis really dying? I cannot tell you yes or no, but I'm gonna try to present you some kind of numbers on fact, and we can decide together after this panel. So first one, I've been seeing some people using citation numbers, but citation number is sometimes misleading because if we reject every paper, there's no citation, and as we know, right? So in a way, maybe I think we should look at the summation numbers. So what I went to my laptop, I checked all my email in the back because I have to manually dig up all the numbers. So as you know, in 2012, we were converted from a VIS conference to a CiteVis conference. So as you can see, in 2010 and 11, the second column, we had submission about 180, 190. But keep in mind, back then there were CiteVis as well a few of InfoVis paper. Even though there was an InfoVis conference, people still submitted this as a main conference. Now you can see the number drops after 2012 to 154. That's the year we actually officially moved into CiteVis conference. And if you look at the line chart in the bottom, actually the number is actually not plunging down, it's actually stabilized. The first year is 154, then we got 120, so this year is actually not the lowest, I want to argue. So actually 2013, for some reason, we only get 126 submissions. Then the number climbed up, then go down. So this becomes a very natural trend. But one thing I want to remind you guys is that there was a LDAP. So many people actually originally submitted to SciVis, they found out LDAP is a better fit because they're working on large data. Those papers could have been submitted to SciVis. So I put it now, if you add together, it actually went back to before 2011, and actually without including any InfoVis papers. So what I want to argue is that even though the citations, you know, maybe is going down, I don't necessarily think the submissions or people working on the field is going down. So that's my first thing I want to present to you. Second of all, I want to speak from the market. People say, hey, InfoVis and the VAST, they have 200 submissions, 170 submissions. You guys have about 110, 20, 30. Now, well, we are working on a CiteVis problem, right? If you're working on a CiteVis problem, you need to consider what's the population of a scientist. You cannot expect everybody to work on a science problem. So actually, I went to this Population Reference Bureau. So actually, in 2012, they report number about the workforce. They actually look at the US scientist and engineer workforce ratio. And you can see it has been very stable, 5%. So meaning in the entire United States, I'm pretty sure it's going to be similar in other countries, 5% of the population working in scientific or engineering problems. So if there are 5% of people working on science problem, you're not going to expect people, we have 60% of people working on SciVis problem, right? So I would just say this is actually SciVis is a area sometimes harder to get in compared to understand baseball data, NBA data, right? We really need to identify your application, your collaborators. So even in the future when the SciVis paper number is going down or stabilizing a very small number, I'm not surprised. But that doesn't mean that we should be sentenced to death. Next. So maybe people argue, say, hey, you guys have nothing to work on. There's no challenges. So I went to a paper published in 2012 by Pak Wang, myself, Chaomin Chen, and Chris Johnson, and Rob Ross, about the top 10 challenges of visual analytics, not just CiteVis. So if you read through it, you're going to find out, hey, in situ, interaction, large data, databases, algorithms, data movement, uncertainty, parallelism. So anything I point here, I hope you agree they are actually CiteVis problems. Meaning if anybody tries to say there's not much challenge left, but we need to go back to read that 2012 paper, those top 10 challenges, I strongly believe there are still challenges even now. So our job is not done, so we should not just retire and waiting for death to come. Now, people might say, okay, the challenges are here, and you run out your tricks. You just couldn't figure out any way to solve them. So I think the best way to look at it is probably looking at the topics. Now, I was in this excellent talk yesterday by Petra Eisenberg et al., that keyword, KeyVis. That's something I wanted to do myself, and I'm glad to see has been done by other people. So I just, they have this website, very nice website. So I just, as I was listening to the talk, I type in some keyword. So that's what we find out. So I type one and rendering. So there's 137 papers. This is, keep in mind, this is author keywords. Sometimes authors are not, they just not necessarily type everything. Like my student, a lot of times they are sloppy. They just type something and they claim they are done. Actually, they are not comprehensive, but that's okay. So this is only author's keyword. So as you can see, one rendering got peaked at about 2006, and then it went down. Fine, maybe that's a bad sign. So let me type isosurface. Almost same thing, 2004, it got peaked. I think that's a time, I would say, the basic techniques got mature, right? Then go up, there's a lot of problems unsolved, and then we get a peak, and then people start running out of idea, then it went down. Fine. Then I check FlowVis, similar trend, but FlowVis has a little bit uniform distributions because I think people are still working on FlowVis. We still have FlowVis, VectorVis sections. Then I say, that's not very encouraging me for this panel. Then I say, why don't I type another word, visual analytics. And this is what we got. You can see there's nothing, absolutely nothing before 2006, but it really picks up. Continue. And I started to remember, even now, my paper, I put a visual analytics. Because that's why people think what visualization is all about. We are analyzing data. We're not just doing some rendering. So that doesn't mean say anything. That doesn't mean that CiteVis become irrelevant. Because all the three companies should belong to the same conference. Everybody's doing visual analytics. So that doesn't mean much. Now, so I decided to look at my own. So I said, well, if people say you guys are run out of ideas, and I would say, okay, why don't I look at myself, what I've been doing in the past, actually 3 decades. So I'm gonna look at my just, you know, as an example, I can track anybody for their career and see what they're doing, maybe try to figure it out, maybe yes, indeed, people who are used to be diehard CiteVis researchers, they're not anymore because they have nothing to talk to do. So, because I know myself, right, so I can just give it. So a little bit about myself. I went to Stony Brook under Ari in 1990. That was the first IEEE VIS conference. I spent 2 years there. Then I went to Utah under Chris Johnson for 4 years. And then I went to NASA Ames. Actually, if you don't know, in 90s, NASA Ames had peak time. All my colleagues, when I present FlowVis paper, the whole room is packed. People have to stand outside. Then I went to Ohio State for that, spent my last 17 years. So I just want to lend you my background. So what I've been doing in the past 3 decades and continue to still feel very, very enthusiastic about it. So for the first decade, that was my, you know, the student time and also my first job, NASA Ames. I most spent my time on speeding up existing algorithms. Of course, that's because I was a graduate student. I tried to learn. And in the meantime, I tried to think about what I just published. So what did I do? Button rendering, ISO surface, FlowVis. Those are algorithms just being proposed or just being invented. So of course, there are a lot of little things to work on. So for example, this actually, I dig out the proceeding. I took pictures. Now, so this, so for example, I was, when I saw my advisor, Chris Johnson, showing me his animation about this biomatic simulation, I asked him, how do you get those animations? He said, I generate one frame by one frame at a time. So I said, well, obviously there's a need for quicker algorithms. So my first paper was about something called differential boundary rendering, about how to do one animation quick. Then in the 90s, there was a lot of work on isosurface extraction. So then I was very lucky. So working with my colleague, we work on spun space problem. And in the meantime, there's so many other papers like, you know, Bajaj and Pascucci, and then Ito and Signoli. Then of course, in the end of 90s, the algorithm pretty much, you know, stabilized there. So, and also time varying data, you know, for boundary rendering for isosurface, and also that was when the leak was proposed. So this is my first decade. I spent my time enhancing existing algorithms to make them more useful. Now the second decade, there's a lot of work to be done. I continue to improve the existing algorithm, but I sort of got bored. The second decade I was at Ohio State. So I started to come up with thinking about, like, you know, when we always play the same data set again and again and again, how much information is there? When are we done? So I was thinking about this 10 years ago. So what I did was, okay, so in the meantime, I tried to make it look prettier by adding different appearance. And I tried to make a C placement algorithm so that it become more easier to use. And then also I tried to improve boundary rendering. But in the meantime, I said, well, we got to have some theory. Because you don't know how much you have already learned from data set. So that's actually when I started working with my student working on information theory. Because information theory will quantify the amount of information in your data set. And then from there, actually, I found a lot of things can be done and continue to the third decade of my research. So in the third decade, we have this new theory. No, old theory used, we taken from other field, applied to visualization. But I realized it can be applied to level data selection, multivariate, C placement, everything. So in the third decade, that's the half of this 10 years, then I continued to expand it. Then as a CiteVis person, we can never escape from big data problem. Data only gets bigger and bigger and bigger. So I went back to parallel this, parallel that. So I'm going to show you. And finally, the data gets too big. I tell myself, we cannot live with the old way of data anymore. So I started working more on the statistics and distribution. So then, you know, you can see here, right? As I go, I have not done much about rendering, isosurface. So even the picture here you see is more like a VAST, more like information visualization. Because, okay, I need to expand the theory of information theory to, you know, flow, C placement, multivariate. That's the challenging problem. And then, because I started working on distribution, because I don't think we should work on raw data, we can't afford to do it anymore. So then there's a histogram issue, and there's how do you do feature tracking, not using the raw data? How do you do flow analysis, not using the raw data? And then back to this big data problem, then we still need to work on load balancing, flow guided. They are not solved, because in particular, in my third decade, even a second decade, I work a lot with DOE people. DOE labs that produce bigger and bigger computers, and there's a lot of problems to be solved. And then, like this, and also in situ, that this year we have, Ohio State has an honorable mention paper, we are actually using distributions, the new representation in situ to perhaps solve an old problem. How do you detect GI engine store? But this is a domain-specific problem. And there are always emerging technology, like my student, I cannot hold and they want to play with VR glasses. Okay, go ahead. So they try to find a way to use it. So I would say this is actually the keyword. Just you don't need the resource. This is the keyword from my own paper. As you can see, from the first decade, second, third, the world continued to expand. And I can share with you, the first decade, there was one PhD graduate. That was myself. And the second decade, I graduated 7. And the third decade, only halfway, I graduated 11. So as you can see, anybody declare SciVis is dead, it's insane, because there are so many new problems to work on, and there are so many new people being produced, and I think we're just going to keep going. So, well, this is the end of my defense for my client. So if you look at the number, the size, the challenge, and the topics, so this is my claim. This is my declare. There's no way it's near its death. Maybe let's talk about it after 10 years from now. Thank you.
I had a lot of interesting tables and diagrams and graphs, but they've been used up, so I skipped those. The title I picked here is Introduction to Qualitative Introspection. I really like the template, it had Introduction to, so this is going to be a short introduction to introspection from my perspective. You know, the first question that popped into my head when Bob asked me to be on this panel is like, why me? Why would you like me to talk? I mean, and one of the people who are running in this field, and why would you? And I realized that, you know, maybe he just found a picture of me. So maybe this is, I'm dealing a lot with this kind of death, but it's another thing. And virtual autopsies, this is the worst picture of me ever, I think. But it's been circulating now. So I'm going to provide you with two different introspections and from a qualitative perspective, and try to stick out my neck a little bit and see what happens. Now, the first one is really about SciVis and what is all about, and I'm going to problematize a little bit about the concept of SciVis and what it is. And when I do that, you know, if I ask myself the question, is SciVis dead? So one of the things I sometimes do, you know, a few weeks ago I started thinking about this, and I was sitting in my office, what am I going to say about this? So I found on Skype, I found one of my smart collaborators, Matt Cooper, I think he's sitting in here. So I popped the question to him, Matt, what would you think about the death of SciVis? And his answer was immediate and very insightful, I think. It was one of the best answers I've had to this question. The answer was 42. And the meaning, there's a lot of meaning behind his answer, because it really means that this is a question that is ill-posed. An ill-posed question, and you have to frame the question to get a well-defined answer. So the answer for me is of course, 42. Now, why are we thinking this way? Well, if you look up the definition of visualization or scientific visualization, you find in the dictionaries, you find two different meanings of the word visualization. The first one is that you form a mental image. You know, the example, it's not easy to visualize the future. The second one is to make something visible to the eye. And that second example there, we as a community will have to make them change that one because it's not about dying things anyway. But what does this really mean? You know, and if you take this definition and you start listening to how people are talking about scientific visualization, I hear words when I walk around in the corridor, even in the presentations, I hear people saying things like, we made a visualization. Or they talk about the visualization shows. I would say, let's try to get rid of those phrases. Let's not use visualization in that context because it conveys a false image of what visualization is. Visualization is the process. It's the process of generating some sort of mental image inside of the head. It's not the picture in itself. Referring to something as a visualization, it just leads to thought in the wrong way. So let's, as a community, stop doing that. That's my first question or plead. Now, if you look at, you know, sometimes when I teach, I use this sort of the standard view of the visualization pipeline. You've all seen this, the death in many cases. So, and if you think about, you know, the definition of what it is that we're doing, when I'm out there and I'm talking to, there are thousands of users out there that are interested in talking to us, but primarily they come and they talk to me about things that are at the far end. You know, they have data, they have lots of data. And it's coming from all different sources. Recently, I'm talking to the National Police Force about, you know, their data flow pipelines and what they want to do about it, okay? Is this VIS, is this CiVis to be out there and talking to these people? There's a big question about that. You know, next one is, you know, the people that I talk to in terms of that I see as my peers now are the ones that are doing signal processing, machine intelligence, artificial intelligence, everything like that. That's a domain that has a huge impact on visualization. But in some sense, we're defining that away from us, which is strange because we're in the business of making tools for visualization. That's the same way we have on the interaction side. We have people that are doing a lot of interesting user interfaces, and we as a CiVis community are not really dealing with that either. So we tend to stick in the middle. We feel safe and happy where on the rendering side. And if you define visualization as primarily dealing with the rendering side, then I would say, yes, we're dead, because we can do that. But the challenge is, how do we move beyond that? We should be working all over the place. We should be dealing with all these aspects. It doesn't matter where the actual method comes from. We're integrating the tools, and this is a part of CiVis, and I see that happening in other communities, and this is something that we need to address in sort of an open discussion. How do we embrace all these other aspects of scientific visualization and to provide the tools that we have? So to summarize the first introspection, we are not in the business of creating visualizations. We are developing tools and methods that support visualization, whether that's rendering, whether that's interaction, whether that's data analysis, machine learning, intelligence, whatever it is. Those are the tools that we are using to assemble things that support the process of visualization. Now, the second introspection is something that I'm thinking a lot about, and that's defining what is something that's good. And I think this is pertinent especially to the scientific visualization community, because we do seem to have a trend of being very critical to each other. And let me give an example, and this is completely qualitative. I have no beautiful statistics supporting my claims here, but I'll do it anyway. This is CiVis 20 years ago. The way I perceive it from being in here publishing, reviewing papers. If you look at the dynamic range in quality, you know, papers that are submitted to our conferences, they range from terrible to excellent. And there's a nice distribution. And as a papers chair, as a reviewer, you sit there and you try to define what is acceptable and what's not acceptable. And you say, okay, we define something. Okay, so you end up on one side or the other. 20 years ago, that was a pretty fair process. That's my view of the whole situation, that we could do this in a reasonably well-defined way. What has happened in 20 years? In a maturing community, and maybe the CiVis community, out of all the visualization communities, we are the most mature community, right? What happens when a community is maturing? Well, you're condensing the dynamic range. So everything ends up in the middle. You know, there's still the Hamish Carr who's out on the right side all the time. You know, he's got the excellent papers. He's getting the best paper award all the time. And there are a few people that we don't know that are out on the left side. But most of us are just in the middle. We're good. So what happens then? Well, as a papers chair, you sit there and you say, okay, fine, these are the papers that get in and these are the papers that are out. And that process becomes pretty much a random selection. And that's why you sit there and you're furious with the reviewers, because you think you have a good paper and it should make it, but it doesn't, because you happen to be on the wrong side. And if we're reinforcing the acceptance rates that we have today, most of those papers are going to be rejected. So my viewpoint on this, and this is why I'm sticking out my neck a little bit in this community, I know there are a few people who would strongly disagree with me, is that too many good papers are rejected multiple times, and I keep reviewing the same paper over and over again for different journals, different conferences. And they improve slightly in between, so it's a good process from that view, but it's very expensive, extremely expensive in terms of reviewing and writing. The acceptance rate is a very poor measure of quality. What are we thinking? It's the most artificial measure you can ever imagine. I could volunteer to submit 10 very bad papers. You can reject them all and the acceptance rate will be better. Why are we using acceptance rate? The number of available slots at the conferences should not limit the number of papers that we are publishing. And this is particularly true for the SciVis community, where we have this problem with the condensed range. We should have more papers that are being published. How do we do that? Well, we should learn from other communities that are more journal-driven. They are having, I come to the conference here. Where is the most energy you find at the conference? Well, it's in the workshops and perhaps in the panels. I hope in this one, even though it's on death. this is where the things are happening. It's not in the paper sessions. They're interesting. They're very good. But it's very junior people who are presenting their work to a very senior community. That's kind of strange. Why don't we have senior people talk about their visions instead? That would be much more interesting. So more discussions, perhaps less on paper presentations, even though they're interesting. They're online. Okay. Now, other communities are doing this. And you know, for those of you who know me, I grew up in the physics community. And you know, if there's any community that's dead, it's physics. Physics is a dead community in many ways. But it's still a vibrant community, and there are many different reasons for that. I mean, they have the Nobel Prize. We don't have that. But one thing that they're doing is that they have lots of journals. Their meetings are primarily based on discussions, on presentations of ideas, visions, everything like that. And the journals, you know, they have the physical review. That's where I published a lot of my stuff before, physical review A. And they fill it up, so it's filled with pretty good papers. You know, the dynamic range in physics is just there in the middle. What did they do? Well, they spawn more journals. So they have physical review A, B, C, D, E, F, G, and so on. Okay. And for the best papers, they invent physical review letters. And to summarize their work, they have reviews of modern physics. Maybe this is a model that we should be thinking about. Now, going back to the death of scientific visualization. Now, these are the items if you extract them from Bill's paper. Now, visualization alone is not a solution. Check, I would agree with that. But the quotes mean that it's perhaps the wrong definition that he's using in this paper as well. Visualization is a critical part of many applications. Yes, of course, check, very good. That's the way it should be. This one. The community lacks application domain knowledge. I would disagree. And that's maybe one of the big changes that has happened in the past 10 years, that we are more and more aware of the application domain knowledge. And, you know, things like VAST is an example of that. Some of the papers that are coming into the SciVis conference is also examples of that. Visualization, again in quotes, has become commodity. Great, I agree. Wonderful. We don't have to deal with that anymore. We can do volume rendering on the GPU, and that's out there. We don't have to deal with that. We can focus our efforts on other things. And that's what we need to do. Okay, visualization is not having an impact in applications. I would strongly disagree. And I wish that Bill would be here, because I would show him this picture. This is the only picture of my own work I'm going to show you. So here's one of our touch tables. Here's marching cubes and volume rendering together at the same time with millions of users of the next generation of researchers. And it's out there. It's being used. It has a huge impact. So, is SciVis dead? You know, this is the ultimate question. And I know that you probably haven't seen this. Let me see. This is Max von Sydow and the seventh seal. And he's playing chess with death. So it's all in Swedish, you know, so you probably wouldn't understand what he's saying. But in the free translation, if you think about our community, are we talking about the death here or not? No. I would like them to talk more about the need for tools and for multiple scattering in the clouds. All right. Thank you very much.
So, now we've moved on to the unscripted part of the panel, the fun, exciting stuff. We're opening up the conversation to the audience now. So you have a very unique opportunity, a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity, to interrogate these master geeks of SciVis. Do we have any opinions or questions from the audience that would like to be shared? Please state your name and affiliation before you give us your excellent question.
Hi, Annie Preston from UC Davis. I didn't hear anyone mention diversity, and I think this is a way in which visualization and computer science are not really keeping up with other scientific fields. I think in other fields they're talking more about these issues. And I think if we're going to keep attracting people who do interdisciplinary research or come from a scientific domain, we kind of need to keep up in that respect. So what do you think?
If I understood the question correctly, it's why didn't we talk about diversity? Is that a good interpretation of the question? That's a good question.
Because we're all bad white guys. I think that actually the science, many of the sciences, biology in particular, are much more balanced, at least in gender diversity. And so I find that brings more diversity into the work that I do. As far as the people of color, I don't know how to solve that problem. And I think, you know, we try things, but it's another kind of process and knowledge gathering that we just haven't solved it yet. So certainly it will help, but I don't know how to do it.
I think diversity, I think we're doing okay. This is my own opinion. I'm not white, of course. So actually, if you look at China, there's a huge number of people doing this nowadays. And then because IEEE SciVis and SciVis and spread out to the whole world. And for example, next year at the SciVis, we have a paper chair with Lady Ingrid, right? So I think we're trying to do stuff. We still have to attract more people to our field, but I think we are kind of keep that in our mind.
You know, I can only reiterate what I said about the way that we are reviewing things. So I think we are scaring off, you know, newcomers to the field. We're scaring them away by rejecting their papers. The first thing they do, the first thing a graduate student gets is a nasty rejection letter from some senior scientist. That's not a good way of attracting new people to the community. So I think that's one of the issues that we need to deal with. And what kind of methods do we apply for doing that? I think we should. I mean, there are ways of doing deconstruction and doing a gender analysis, for instance, on the way that we write things. I mean, we did that on one of our policy documents recently. And, you know, this a gender researcher came in, looked at just the way, just the grammar that you use in your selection criteria is very gendered. And I think we should be better at that. And I think this community is suffering a lot from that because there's been such a dominance, a male dominance. But diversity stretches across other boundaries, not only gender. I mean, there's lots of those cultural, there's disciplinary boundaries as well that we should be looking at and gaining that kind of respect. But I think as a community, we're ready for that. But whether that's in the context of SciVis or generally in this, I don't know.
Sure. Okay, so I have a few words on this too. So actually when I taught the undergraduate visualization course 5 or 6 years ago, I had about 10 students in a course, and now I have 100. So that's a large number of undergraduates, senior undergraduates taking a course. And that the way I attracted or unwillingly attracted them by putting more data, the keyword data science into the syllabus. And they all want to do like data analysis, and I did. And that class really reflects the general, like in terms of composition, the general composition of our department. Of course, there's more males than females, but there's a lot of females. And there's New York already is a very colored sort of environment. There's all kinds of, you know, people there that in this class. And what I really liked there, I told them, I didn't give them any data set to analyze. I just told them, why don't you go yourself and find a data set and then write a little bit of a report, like 2-page report, why you chose the data set and what kind of thing you want to achieve with it. And they wrote, I was just unbelievably impressed by what they wrote and how deeply they thought about the data and what they wanted to achieve with them. And they infused their own sort of social environment into this. Some people came from a poor neighborhood, so they wanted to study like in New York City, like how poor neighborhoods, how the education is there and why they succeed and why not and what they can do about this. And other people wanted to study Pokemon characters. Okay, well, that's maybe not that significant. But that moves them, and they really become associated with them, and then they start to analyze the data, and they really become vested. And that's the way you can attract this new talent, because they now all believe in scientific visualization. I teach them data science, I teach them volume rendering, and they have a hall of fame of the nicest picture they generate. You know, so this is a way to get people involved by giving them a purpose and then letting them be invested in that purpose and really become involved and engaged. And then I do peer review, they actually have to review each other's works, you know, and they get a little more opinions from the other people. And they actually showed us the job interviews. I've master's students, they told me, I opened my laptop or and showed my visualizations I made for my class, and they got the job. You know, they all have like nice jobs now, using D3 visualizations and other things. You know, it's data science, and that is all a very hot topic. And it attracts the females and males, and black and white. I mean, it doesn't really matter. It doesn't seek any race or color or gender.
Nice going, Klaus. I need to take some notes to improve my class. Yes, Dave, you can say something.
So Klaus went back to undergrad, but I think it actually goes back a lot further than that. And some of the things as a parent that I've watched that I think are promising are, any of you ever do, Americans do Science Olympiad? Just one, wow. Anybody do First Lego League or the First Robotics stuff? Just one. I guess maybe these are a little too recent, but those are things in middle school and in high school that get kids connected to science and robotics. And the first stuff is pretty traditional, male. Doesn't have a lot of the underrepresented groups that you would really want to engage. But the Science Olympiad somehow is much more balanced. And so I think there's some really interesting things to look at in earlier education. And, you know, maybe it creeps into freshman year or, you know, the beginning of college too. But I think somehow we're not getting those groups in at the from the beginning. And I don't know why. Maybe there's hope.
We have a long queue of exciting questions here. I know the next one. I have a psychic wave coming at me, like saying this is going to be an interesting interesting comment or question. Next, please.
Thanks for setting me up for failure here. That's very helpful. So I want to piggyback on the previous question because I think it's a really important one. And I was listening to Han-Wei saying that we're doing fine, and I was looking around the room, and I'm guessing about 20% women in here, maybe 15%. I'm not seeing a single person of color in here. Even the number of Asians is embarrassingly low here. I don't think we're doing fine. This is not what I would count as doing well. And InfoVis is doing better than that. I mean, it's still not where it should be, but I think that is an important question. We need to ask that, is where are the people coming from? And are we reaching the folks that are going to keep carrying the torch, because if we're all, you know, old white guys, at some point that's going to end. So I think that's an important question, but I actually have a different one. And uh, I was actually enjoying your presentations more than I thought I would. And it was fun watching you all more or less gracefully dodge the question. So that was interesting. And I was very charmed, Klaus, that you don't know what a choker is. It's a very, very academic thing of you to say. I actually, Nuska Smith back there is wearing one, she can show you. It's a fashion thing. It comes back every 20 years, but you don't have to wait that long to find out what those things are. But I have a question. I don't know if it's a good one, we'll see. But I looked this up on Wikipedia. You know the stages of grief? There's denial, anger, bargaining, depression, and acceptance. And I'm trying to figure out, are you at the denial stage or bargaining? I'm not seeing the anger so much, but maybe it's because you're all academics and it's all a bit subdued. Maybe it's, but I would put you somewhere in between that. So maybe between anger and bargaining, perhaps somewhere. Is that where we are, or what do you think?
My psychic powers are working today.
I know this one, and I actually thought about mentioning this in my talk, but then I wanted to give, like, because it's a really, I think it's a cycle, not like I accept something and then I move on. I accept, the only thing I may accept is like the old CiteVis, I've accepted that it's no longer working and I'm going to find the new CiteVis. I mean, I started out with water rendering, 3D. My, you know, for a long time, and I thought, well, the 3D is very boring, you know, let's go to like 4D, 5D, 100D, right? And that's what I'm doing now, right? So it's just moved on. And I use simple techniques. You know, I gave a keynote at Pacific Research on this about a while ago. I mean, there's still sampling. There is still, you know, depth to it. It's just now, you know, a different depth. There's all these techniques, all these principles still come in, right? Sampling and all this stuff that happens in modern rendering still there. You know, and the data, you know, it's just a little, it's now non-linear or irregular samples then, and they no longer have a spatial, but to give them a spatial reference. Right? So these things still, I just accept that all CiteVis has come to an end. All the rendering is a little bit on the downside, but I'm, you know, but you can use these same technologies to in a new context, right? And that's why I'm thinking it's a cycle and not like a, you know, terminal thing. It just overlaps, right? There's a new thing that sort of blends in and then goes on. Otherwise, you know, this is how the world works anyway, right? Otherwise, we all, you know, that's how I think works. Makes me fall asleep at night.
Any other comments?
I want to say that there's nothing wrong with denying something that's not true. I'm the person who strongly believe in the law of attraction. When you don't think it's true, then never think it's true, and then keep doing, and think about it. So, and I think many people hear the same thing, right? You must have paper rejected. I remember, like, our information theory view selection paper, we first time submitted to InfoVis, we got 11112. People say, what's the point? Yeah, but from that point on, you can see that a lot of information theory, there's a lot of, you know, technique based on that. So, again, I say there's nothing wrong with denying things that are not true.
I can just make a comment that the diversity question is a very good question. You know, there are the different kinds of diversity. There's the ethnic diversity, and then there's the gender diversity. And clearly the gender diversity thing is a little bit not quite there. But that, I don't think we're going to solve that problem in this panel, like the gender diversity. That's next year's panel. I think that's been on many panels. If anybody has the answer to the gender diversity, then they're going to be famous, I think.
Yeah, I mean, on the death again, I mean, trust me, I've been in many other communities and talked. I've never been in a community that talks so much about its own death as this one. You know, I came in here and I thought, wow, great, this is like an exciting field. I can provide solutions to all those problems that I've seen in other places. So for me, I guess I'm still in denial in some sense. It's the, you know, it's the Norwegian blue. I'm pining for the fjords here. Yeah. But more seriously, I think that maybe CiteVis as a concept, and the name CiteVis doesn't really make sense anymore. And maybe that's where we should start and seeing what should we call. We're doing good stuff. We're doing excellent things, needed things, and all of the tools that we have, they're being utilized in many other different contexts. But maybe the notion of CiteVis is something that we have hammered to death because we've overused the word, and we've limited. I mean, exactly what I showed. And I mean, by defining ourselves away from the interesting stuff, we are slowly killing the concept of SciVis. Maybe it's too late to save it. I don't know. But maybe finding something else that has a more descriptive nature of what it is that we're really doing would be a better thing. And unless we do it here, it will happen in other places.
I have one more comment for Robert. Like, so you one time you actually pioneered this sort of. I remember this like a long time ago. You said like SciVis and InfoVis can be friends, right? And but meaning InfoVis can like SciVis can embrace InfoVis techniques and make it stronger. And you had compelling demonstrations of this. But the other way around, it can also be true, right? I mean, SciVis can be InfoVis's friend, but InfoVis doesn't seem to really adapt these techniques a lot, right? I mean, I've been sending papers, but I never get them accepted. You know, so I don't know if there's any InfoVis people here, you know, so, but anyway, I mean, it doesn't seem to be quite go like the same, the equilateral, right? That it's like, you know, we apply all these InfoVis techniques and became into visual analytics, but on the other hand, you know, they sort of, you know, it's a very interesting trend. I mean, I just observed this from my own experience. Maybe it's not true. Maybe I'm just paranoid or something.
That brings us to this question, which one's the superset? And maybe InfoVis is the superset of SciVis.
I don't know. I haven't drawn the Venn diagram yet.
I can't resist making one more comment about the diversity, because it is a very interesting topic. And I read a book on this topic called Why Men Don't Listen and Women Can't Read Maps, How We're Different and What to Do About It. It's a catchy title, but it's an interesting book, and it's about that diversity topic. And if you're interested, I recommend reading that. Next question. Name and affiliation, please.
Erica Yang from Rutherford Appleton Laboratory, one of the UK national laboratory. I'm from a big laboratory, have all sorts of big machines, instruments, neutrons, synchrotron, high power laser, material science, and the spectrum of them. Now, what I see is actually totally is now, SciVis is really, it's at the thinking point of going the big boom. That's what I see. But however, the reason being, that the paper submission or the community seeing the number doesn't look good is that we're hitting a very big bottleneck, roadblock. If you think about a range of, it's not the demand or requirement not there from my point of view, it's actually the bar getting into this field is very high now. Because in order to do sensible scientific visualization, for example, material science, you really need to know, in our laboratory, you need to know materials, some understanding of material science, experimental science, computational science, visual analytic, machine learning, computer science, software engineering, HPC, you name it, mathematician. So a whole spectrum of disciplines, knowledge, experience, expertise really need these days. So that's what I mean by the bar of getting into this SciVis. I really think this is SciVis. It's very high. Then the question for the panel really is that, do you think what can be done to address that, lower that bar? I mean, I'm really interested to see your view about that.
That actually is a good question. So actually D3 has lowered the bar, and then now Vega Lite has lowered the bar for InfoVis, right? I mean, now it's very easy to make these visualizations on the web browser. So now if we just need something like this in SciVis, where people can create easily, just create like a flow field or like analyze something and then put it on the map, right? And maybe merge it with D3. I don't think we have libraries like this that are so easy to use, right? And so easily integrated. That may be one way to lower the bar. If I understand you correctly.
That's actually very interesting, because that goes back to your early comments about diversity, about the white versus other sort of minority or whatever. So if you think about it, InfoVis, the availability of D3 and the whole spectrum of JavaScript and all that, and if you go to the InfoVis sessions, there's a whole lot more Asian people, and I'm not picking on that, but I myself is Chinese. You can see the bar is actually a lot easier for people to get into that research area and do something with the data using this popular framework and build on that. SciVis is really, it's difficult. difficult. The tools are difficult, the knowledge are difficult, the spectrum of knowledge and expertise requires are difficult. The reason, one of the guess I have, sort of conjecture I have, the reason being a lot of why people here, rather than sort of Chinese or other Asian people, is because the range of the scientific, deep scientific discovery investment in the past in the past few decades has been all in the West. But if you think 10 years later you come to the conference, if the conference still exists, I hope. 10 years later, if you come to a SciVis conference, you will see a totally different demographics in the population. Because the range of the big science investments in China, in India, and all that is changing, it's rapidly changing now. So that population will change, I think. Yeah.
I can give a brief answer to the question about the bar, and I agree, it's a huge problem. I think the solution that we're working on, I wrote a report to the Swedish Science Council on this, is human infrastructure. We need, as a research community, we need to recognize the fact that the significant effort that goes into working with applications, with user communities, is actually an engineering effort. So for each of the projects that we're setting up, there's a small research component, but there's a massive effort in terms of engineering. So we're not as good as other communities in having a progression of a base level of services that we are basing the research up on. Take a place like, again, the physics community, take a place like an accelerator, like the big systems at CERN. I mean, there are thousands of physicists there, but most of them are actually accelerator engineers and detector engineers. There's a handful of physicists that are doing the research, the science there. And I think we need to recognize that in our community too, that we need to have a lot of software people, a lot of solutions people, even hardware people that are providing the basis for the applications that are benefiting our communities, our application communities, but also provides the basis for our research projects, because it's not going to happen with PhD students.
So one thing I always feel very strongly is that we don't have enough data sets. So in our field, we particularly need data set because we cannot just download from Yahoo, from Google. But a lot of people protect the data set for good reason. But there are actually people who don't care about releasing a data set, but like just don't know how to. So I would say one way to lower the bar is provide a way for people to contribute the data set, explain the problem. So this is actually why I think the CiteVis content is so valuable. People are still using the Isabel data set, still using the IronFront data set, but we don't have enough. So for people who don't know much to enter this field.
What everybody says resonates with me as well. I think one of the things about InfoVis is that there are tens of thousands or hundreds of thousands of people who will use those tools. And for SciVis, there's tens or hundreds. And so that means there aren't going to be the same development efforts to make friendly, easily accessible tools. And the data sets are much bigger, and there are not as many of them. So everybody doesn't walk around with, 16 SQL databases. I mean, everybody does walk around with 16 SQL databases on their laptop, but very few of us have 16 volume, vector-valued volume data sets of fluid flow simulations or diffusion MRI scans. I have those, but only the SciVis community has that kind of stuff, and it's a much, much smaller group. And so the demand is harder to meet unless you bring in specialists and build collaborative teams that where there's the expertise to do to build those really pretty complicated tools that are kind of one-offs. That's not going to happen in this in a market-driven kind of way.
Also, on a historical note, there were two bars that were introduced. I think one of the bars I remember is in 2003 when the application papers went from 4 pages to 8 pages. So that raised the bar on the application papers. And then in 2006, the bar went up again from conference proceedings to the special issue of TVCG. So personally, I would love to bring back the conference track papers and the short style papers, to make it a little bit more accessible to a wider audience.
And I would encourage people to send posters. Posters are a pretty good way to get something that's not going to make it over the bar yet because you're still working on it into the conference and get here and talk to people about it.
finally, in case you don't notice, we do have a VIP visualization in practice session this year that's new, so we're going to continue to go. That's actually the way to encourage applications.
Thank you.
So you guys know, I know all of you, you guys know I don't generally get up and say anything, but Han-Wei, when you said we were fine, I was catapulted out of my chair. We are not fine. We are not
your
fine.
Your name and affiliation?
Kelly Gaither, Texas Advanced Computing Center. And I've been around this community since, what, 91, 92? We are better. We are not fine by any stretch of the imagination. And here's what I think is the basic problem, is that what we know about recruiting our girls and our underserved communities, African Americans, Latinos, is that oftentimes they care about the why and we focus as a community on the how. So I think, you know, in fact, we have evidence of this. We have done some things at TAC where we are working on advanced computing for social change, which brings everybody to the table. We're using data analytics and visualization to tackle these violent uprisings surrounding the Black Lives Matter movement. But you could replace that with almost anything else. So the kids coming up, it's not that they're not smart enough. I think we rely on sort of, we can't do anything about the problem because we aren't in the K through 12 community filling the pipeline. But we can. We actually can do a lot. And we're seeing evidence of this. So for our first challenge, we made an effort to recruit from communities. We made an effort to work on problems we know these kids, these millennials and post-millennials care about. These kids don't know anything but war and terrorism and violence as a means of solving problems. They have social issues in their lives that they care about much more than they care about whether they're making an A and a B on an assignment in school. Oftentimes these kids have economic issues that force them to work full time. We have in our inaugural challenge, which is gonna be at supercomputing, 60% women, 40% men, 35% African American, 35% Latino. But here's why I think it's probably not working in the VIS community. One, we don't focus explicitly on it. One, the papers that come in that talk about the why, the applications papers, don't fare well. Because the first thing that reviewers say is what's new and novel about this. The aha moments are not very well celebrated and they're not valued. Until we fix some of that problem and until we make it a priority to get these people in here, we will not be fine. So I think as a community, we need to get together. We need to stop worrying about the boundaries between SciVis and InfoVis. Who cares? It's a silly question. VIS is going to go on and on and on, and it's silly to talk about it. I'll still be doing SciVis-y things. I'll still be doing InfoVis-y things in 20 years, God willing, right? I don't worry about when I have a problem, whether I'm going to be using a SciVis technique or an InfoVis technique. My techniques are driven by the problems I'm trying to solve. And I'll leave with one last point. I don't really have a question. I just was catapulted to come say this. So I'm reading Ben Schneiderman's book, The New ABCs of Research. In there, he speaks to coming up a level and using our powers for good and not evil and focusing on the problems where it's bigger than any one of us. I think if we start as a community, and this includes InfoVis and VAST, celebrating these interdisciplinary problems where we're really making an impact that make a difference in lives, that's when I think we'll start to see a positive change.
Thank you, Kelly.
Kelly, I agree with you completely. So I guess when I say we're fine, I think I probably did not think carefully. I think I would say opportunity-wise, because I came to this country as an immigrant, as a foreign student, I feel this community treat me very well, give me all the opportunities, but I think we need to go out and encourage people. On that, Ohio State is hiring. So a diversity candidate is always, always welcome. So we are actually hiring these people this year, but we'll focus a little bit on InfoVis. So.
Thanks to Han-Wei Shen for getting Kelly out of a chair to give us that great inspiration.
I can just second what you said, Kelly. I think it's great and it's very, very important. But you know, when I go back home, I will be embarrassed to tell my colleagues in other disciplines that we have this panel here, because they don't see us that way. And I think maybe it's in other places, you know, they see us as a very important contribution from the applications perspective. And I think that people are good at it. And each of us, when we go back home, we have these collaborations there. And I agree, I don't care whether it's InfoVis or if it's SciVis. And I would say, let's get rid of those concepts. And I know that many people are supporting that. Let's just do good viz and support our communities. And I also agree with, you know, the notion of the application. And you know, I teach this course on SciVis. And the day after I've had the lecture on medical visualization, the room is just filled with enthusiastic students. It has some effect on the gender balance too, that you see the purpose, the need for your work, and then you can dive into the details when you're motivated by that. And we're not very good at doing that. We should do that already in the first year undergraduate courses, show them the use and the need for the science that we are developing, and we should get better at that. And then this is one of the things that we're doing at my center. You know, we have 100,000 visitors per year coming to our center, and we show them what visualization is good for. And we have the Dome Theater where we do shows about the universe and people get excited about that. And I love it when the six-year-olds come up to me and ask questions about that, getting inspired. So we need to be more inspirational and show the necessity for what we're doing. And I think we have, if any community could do that, it's us. You know, we have images, we can communicate.
I also would just like to insert one comment about the application papers, because a lot of people talk about the application papers. I don't solicit that information, but people come up to me and say, what's going on with the application papers? One interesting observation is, I think it was the year 2005, the evaluation of the application papers disappeared. There was a separate review form for application papers, and it disappeared. So it could be interesting to reintroduce, you know, a slightly modified review form for the application papers.
Well, just before this session, there were all these three fields had like application papers, right? Mm-hmm. As I look at the program. So actually, Kelly, I really applaud your efforts. I mean, this is really amazing, right? I mean, I've been trying to establish a summer school too for, like, you know, new talent. It's hard to do, but I really love what you're doing, and it's going to be really an example to push something like this forward also in our university. We maybe need more websites that can show like what we do, and I mean, I try to, as I said, I try to let people analyze their own data in the class. There's a lot of websites out there that you can get lots of data, and that's the way to really get people excited. You know, don't push on them data that you want to get. Find out about, let them just pick, you know, they invest a lot more time. It's all about, they're all, you know, in a young person's schedule, there's all these competing things, right? You gotta make your SciVis or VIS or whatever it is. I'm really for confluence, you know, I don't really care if there's a SciVis or InfoVis or VAST, but if everything would be like VIS, which Chris Johnson introduced, right? I mean, it would be fine by me, right? So it would be nice if there would be a SciVis session in InfoVis conference, you know, because, you know, we had in SciVis old days, we had a InfoVis track, right, that there could be an InfoVis thing. It would all be great, right, to have. It's all a matter of us. It's all a matter of us as researchers and organizers to invite these kind of things, right? It's great to get the word out and get everyone involved and follow that.
Okay, our last question, I guess, before we all run out of the room and celebrate.
Bernice Rogowitz, Visual Perspective. So I wanted to follow up on this idea of this multidisciplinary approach to visualization. So I think that if we look at SciVis, not just in the SciVis conference, but across the whole set of conferences and workshops, I think SciVis is alive and well. I mean, so I think that we see, for example,
rendering and representation techniques that were developed in SciVis being used in the other conferences. And I see approaches from the other conferences being used in SciVis. And I think that it's, you know, I think that what you were talking about is the sort of the size, what is the visualization space? I think that the bigger new emphasis on analytics and what are people trying to see in the data, what are the phenomena they're trying to understand, I mean, that's pervading all of the research in the bigger outline, in the bigger set. So I think that there's been a sort of artificiality of the construct. So maybe SciVis isn't dead, but maybe we've burst out and outgrown these very narrow kinds of rubrics. And so one evidence of the bursting out is that the acceptance rate is so low, and that seems to correlate with the emergence of all these extra workshops and tracks and programs, you know, that don't have, you know, that there's an outlet for these new ideas. Because sometimes when we get to be a little bit narrowly focused, we have a little bit stultified view about what constitutes a paper for my particular area. And things are a little, you know, multidisciplinary or something new. You know, sometimes they don't make it to be accepted. But, you know, so I think that we have to think about the overall overarching structure to really be think of visualization as its multidisciplinary, dynamic, live organism. And then think about how do you want to define the conferences to support that enormous, you know, evolution and excitement that I see.
Thank you.
Well, I mean, we have to be careful that, you know, because then you have such a low acceptance rate that people will just publish their work somewhere else, and then it becomes like another, goes to another community that isn't even sharing our conference spaces, right? And then we lose, it's a bigger, you know, diaspora, right, where people just go away, right, and then move on to another community. We have to, these low acceptance rates are really dangerous. I've reviewed papers where that appeared in some completely different community, and then, you know, maybe these people never come back. They just go to these communities because they're now liked and they know, and they go there and get, you know, it's really dangerous. These low acceptance rates are very, very dangerous, also in terms of citation count, because, you know, if you don't have a lot of papers, there's not a lot of citations. We gotta be, you know, add a few more rooms and have poster short papers and make the papers longer so people can actually cite stuff, you know, and then, you know, 2 pages, maybe have 5 or 6 citations, you know, that doesn't help our community at all, right? And CGNA also only allows like 5 or 6 citations. We're just basically in our little sphere, right? We don't get out.
So I don't think we can solve the problem here. I just wanted to sort of put it on the table as a way of getting the conversation going.
Right.
And I also think that, you know, this whole thing about working in multidisciplinary, I'm trained as a perceptual and cognitive scientist, but, you know, I have papers with people doing finite element modeling of hearts, and I've worked with people at CERN on Higgs boson data. I'm not a physicist, but and I'm not alone. There are many people who are working across these multidisciplinary teams where you bring people with different areas of expertise. And I think that's the future of the exciting projects that will generate our next generation of science.
I agree with many of the things that you're saying. And I would like to emphasize that even though I'm proposing that we should reach out and include more aspects of visualization in our work, I think there's need for a space for some very low-level contributions. Fundamentals, theory, mathematics, and so far it's been the SciVis community that's picked that up, and maybe that would be one way of rebranding ourselves, is to look at the fundamentals and things that we are developing that's actually being used in the other sub-communities as well, so that we're not in a position, we're providing a foundation, that would be a healthier way of looking at it. We need a place for those papers that are hardcore, low-level, and very theoretical.
Absolutely, and where people can find out. Sorry, but people can find out about it. I ended up having lunch with the keynote speaker yesterday, and he's looking at these, you know, sort of points of data that are clouds that are, you know, their interrelationships are evolving over time, You know, he was not aware that there is a whole field in SciVis where people have looked at this. You know, how do you characterize, you know, points? Maybe you don't represent them as points, evolve over time. But to be able to bring that insight to him, that there are people developing the core technologies, but then, you know, make other people who could really use them aware of them, I think that's a very important opportunity.
So, I have one thing to add about this artificial boundary. So actually, starting this year in the steering committee level and the executive committee level conference, they actually are discussing hopefully can merge this into big one conference with many, many tracks. So if you agree with this, please make your voice heard by people around you and in particular by the steering committee and executive committees. Okay. This should not be a secret that even as a small subcommittee currently being formed to look into this. So please make your voice heard.
Okay, as much as I would like this panel to keep going on forever, we should probably wrap it up and, well, kill it, or...
I just have a quick comment and a call to action.
We'll continue on over the lunch, I think. I think we should wrap it up, because we're already 5 minutes over, and it's a conflict of interest. Sure. You want to do one?
I just want to make a quick comment and a call to action.
Outvoted?
It's not a question.
Okay.
I have a comment and a call to action. From the perspective of someone who's not inside this, and as a millennial, I was interested in this panel because it told a compelling story. How can SciVis tell better stories? And then my call to action is, may I suggest a call for papers extending towards the InfoVis side to help understand this problem better.
Excellent. Okay, we'll wrap it up. Thank you for that. Thanks for the panel speakers. I have a graphic already.
You have that?
I don't have your graphic, but I have a graphic.
Okay.
It's called CiteVis 2.
It shows
all the...
CiteVis is one thing,
yeah.
But based on the CiteVis data, you have a nice graphic. You want to quickly have a look at it? It's online.
We need to get it on David Laidlaw's... Because David... I'm using David Laidlaw's thing.
Sometimes it was on late. so you're the second speaker.
Okay.
Are we ready? Okay. Happy Wednesday, everybody.